Crawford for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here. How often do you interact with the President's Council of Economic Advisors?
I'm sorry, how often?
How often do you interact with that council?
I interacted with the chair yesterday.
Really?
Yes.
I would suggest that y'all probably aren't singing from the same hymnal, because you just said that inflation was on a downward trajectory, when in fact the Council of Economic Advisors just said that grocery stores are actually causing inflation to increase, and that was a statement that as recently as February 1st. In fact, here's an article I'm happy to share with you. Biden takes aim at grocery chains over food prices. So it says here, President Biden has begun to accuse stores of overcharging shoppers as food costs remain a burden for consumers and a political problem for the president. He coined the phrase, I don't know that he coined it, but he used the phrase shrinkflation to describe how packaging, basically smaller portions in a bag charging the same price for, is having an impact on prices at the grocery store as well. So, you know, these accusations and charges and things of this nature about the evil Republicans just don't hold water. I think probably you should go revisit your Council of Economic Advisors, and maybe I'll get on the same page, because we're hearing mixed messages now from you and from the Council of Economic Advisors. There wasn't a question there, Secretary. last year when you testified before the committee, I asked you about the adverse effect wage rate. You mentioned at the time that you preferred a solution for the AEWR was to pass the Farm Workforce Modernization Act. And we all know that the bill had significant issues that were unrelated to the adverse effect wage rate that kept it from becoming law. So I don't think that was necessarily the answer to the problem. So since you were here last year, my friend Mr. Davis and I have been leading the Agriculture Labor Working Group. We've been hearing from everyone, and everyone has talked about, when I say everyone, I'm talking about stakeholder groups, ag employers across the country that have come in to share their concerns. And the prevailing sentiment was that the adverse effect wage rate continues to be a huge problem. It's an impediment to the efficient functioning of the H-2A program. Georgia, for example, has seen a more than 20% increase in the AEWR in the last 2 years, completely unsustainable. So do you agree that Congress needs to reform AEWR in such a way as to ensure predictable and sensible wage levels for H-2A employers?
I think it makes sense for Congress to, if there are problems with the Farm Worker Modernization Act, to fix that and pass it, because it would create stability, it would create a range, it would create a predictability in the system.
Let me ask you this, changing subject real quick here. As you know, in many USDA programs, especially in rural development, there are costly and time-consuming environmental processes that ultimately end in the project being a categorical exclusion from NEPA. The current system is a barrier to entry to potential borrowers, lenders, and grantees to participate in the system. When they do, they often spend much time and money to meet paperwork requirements. All of it keeps funds from being deployed in rural America. The Department of Energy has already issued rules to make charging stations and solar projects categorically excluded within the DOT, and the Department of Homeland Security then adopted for their departments. My question is, what steps is USDA taking to implement the statutory categorical exclusions listed in the Fiscal Responsibility Act, specifically loan guarantees? And if no action has been taken yet, when can we expect actions to be taken by USDA to implement those provisions?
We use categorical exclusions on a regular basis in our programs. When there's an opportunity to use it, we do use it. I'm particularly aware of how often we use it in the Forest Service in order to move processes along.
Okay.
85% of the activities that we've done in our Forest Service the last 3 years have used CE. So we're not opposed to using it. We actually look for opportunities to use it.
Oh, I hope that's true, because I have some constituents that are highly concerned with that. Let me shift gears again. Hopefully I can get an answer on this question. Your comments last month, you said, quote, here's the problem. Reference prices help a subset of farmers, end quote. These comments worry many farmers across the district, across my district and across the country, at putting in the hard work of feeding and clothing the world. And to be clear, when I say farmers in this context, I mean those who are producing our food and fiber at scale. You focused a lot of your attention on climate. But when you talk about farmers, you often talk about USDA's role in protecting what I would call more hobby farmers. These are folks I certainly care about, and I don't believe they should be completely ignored by USDA programs, but many of them are not full-time farmers or truly dependent on income from the farm to keep them financially afloat. And alone, our country and the world can't be dependent on their output, which is less than 20% of all agricultural production. You acknowledged that earlier in your statement. So my time's run out, but I will yield back.